وسلم تسليما كثيرا أما بعد. We close out this blessed day by a last reminder. 7:28 p.m. Saturday, April 27th, 2019, which is approximately, I think now is the 21st of Sha'ban, if I'm not mistaken. The 22nd of Sha'ban, or it will be the 22nd of Sha'ban, after Maghrib, I think. It will be the 22nd night. Somebody has 22nd of Sha'ban? Does he have, today's the 22nd? I thought tonight was the 22nd. For the 22nd of Sha'ban, the year 1440, after the migration of the Prophet, alayhi salatu wasalam. And we seal this and conclude this seminar that I think was very beneficial, very successful. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reward everyone that attended and benefited from their time in attending these lectures in order to not only aid the community, but also to hear something that inshallah that will be a benefit for them and a benefit for their religion in preparation for the hereafter and for death. For what I wanted to talk about will not be, I'll try not to be too long-winded. As everybody say, you're one of those out too long-winded. But I'll try not to be long-winded, and I'll try to keep everything concise and straight to the point as much as possible due to the lack of time. As I wanted to discuss some of the narrations in regards to how the Siyam affects one's hereafter. How does it affect the state of an individual in the hereafter? Meaning what you do in regards to your Siyam, what will start to take the place in the hereafter in regards to those type of noble, virtuous acts that you committed, or rather you did, excuse me, in drawing close to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, especially during the month of Ramadan. As we find, ya ma'ash al-ikhwa, as we were connected, we were created to actualizing the ubudiyah of Allah. That's the only reason why we are here in this dunya momentarily. We are only here for one purpose, and that's tahqiq ubudiyatillahi subhanahu jalla fil'ula. It's actualizing the servitude and the worship of Allah. Subhanahu wa ta'ala is the reason and the hikmah behind why this creation was brought into existence. For verily, the human being was created to carry out this purpose and to actualize it in accordance to how Allah legislated it. And Allah's legislation is the guidelines that we're supposed to follow. We're obliged to follow it exactly how Allah legislated it. So there's no way we can now think that we're going to do what we want to do or based upon how we feel and think that our actions will be accepted if it is in opposition to what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had legislated of how he wants to be worshipped and how he wants to be, or how he wants his actions to be accepted. They have to be done in a certain manner and in a certain methodology, in a certain way. One of those ways in which one actualizes this purpose of why he was created, one of the best ways, is what we're about to embark upon after some days, which is the month of Ramadan. That is one of the best ways and the most noble and virtuous ways to actualize the servitude in the worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala through that way or that month of Ramadan, which is approaching very fast. For also, that month, you'll find that there's narrations explaining the virtue and the degrees that Allah raises certain individuals and how that month has so many different effects upon one in the hereafter, in which he will see, in which one, as far as in this world, does not see his deeds. He does not see them. But we know on the day of resurrection, one will actually see his deeds. And Allah will create, or Allah will make one's deeds come in the form, or in different forms, excuse me. Allah in the hereafter will allow and make, for example, one's deeds to be in the form of a man or in form of a person. And also of what the message of Allah spoke about in the life of the grave. How a person will come in his grave while he's dead. And he will come in a certain shape and form. And the person will ask, who are you? He said, I am your deeds. So this is to show that what we're going to discuss in these narrations is connected in direct correlation to what? This matter, which I'm speaking about now. Hold on for a second. Furqani. Al-Shahib. So now, just I'm trying to now make everything a little bit shorter than what I want to do. I have to make it a little bit shorter. For now, the narrations of how the month of Ramadan will affect one in his well-being or his state in the hereafter comes in so many different narrations. I'm sure someone have heard, or some of us have heard the narrations on the authority of Talha ibn Ubaidillah about the two men who came from Bali. He says, أن الرجلين من بلي قادما على رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم وكان إسلامهما جميعا. If the sisters can just tone it down just a little bit, we can hear their voice. If she could just tone it just a little bit down, Jazakumullah khaira. He said that there were two men from the town of Bali. He says, and those two men had embarked upon seeing the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and they both became Muslim together. And one of them was more diligent and hardworking than the other. فَغَزَلْ مُجْتَهِدُ مِنْهُمَا فَاسْتُشْهِدْ ثُمَّ مَكَثَ الْآخَرُ بَعْتَهُ سَنَةً ثُمَّ تُوُفِّي. He said, then the one who was hardworking and diligent set out to fight, of course, to fight in the cause of Allah, from the two men, until he attained martyrdom. He was killed in battle, and he attained martyrdom. Then the other remained after him another year until he was overtaken by death. Likewise, so he died after the person who was in battle or set out to attain martyrdom. His partner, his companion after him, died the following year. So Talha, the great Sahabi, and we know Talha ibn Ubaidillah was from those 10 who were promised paradise. Right, everyone? Talha ibn Ubaidillah, the great Sahabi. Rather, he was from the Kibar al-Sahaba. He was from the seniors and the major Sahaba. So Talha says, فَرَأَيْتُ فِي الْمَنَامِ بَيْنَا أَنَا عِنْدَ بَابِ الْجَنَّةِ إذا أنا بهما فخرج خارج من الجنة فأذن للذي توفي فأذن للذي توفي الآخرة منهما ثم خرج فأذن للذي استشهد ثم رجع إلي فقال ارجع فإنك لم يأني لك بعد فأصبح طلحة يحدث به الناس فعجبوا لذلك فبلغ ذلك رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم وحدثوه الحديث فقال من أي ذلك تعجبون. He says, for then, when both of them died, Talha said that I seen them in a dream. He says, where I was by the door of paradise. And he said, and I was next to them. I was in their proximity, meaning I seen them. He says, for one, a person came out of paradise and he gave permission for the one who died last, meaning the one who did not die in battle, the one who now came later, who died after his friend, meaning the one who basically fasted or had an extra year to live, the one who had an extra additional year to live, you would expect it was the opposite. The one who died first was the one in battle, then his friend came after him and lived a year later. But however, Talha basically said what? His friend who died later, he entered paradise before the one who came before him, who died in battle. So they found that very what? Strange. So Talha found that strange. So I said, فَخَرَجَ خَارِجٌ مِنَ الْجَنَّةِ فَأَذِنَ لِلَّذِي تُوُفِيَ الْآخِرَ مِنْهُمَا. So the first that lived a year later, he entered paradise first. Then after that, it was given permission for the one who attained martyrdom, meaning the one who died in battle. He said, ثُمَّ رَجَعَ إِلَيْهِ. Then that person that came out from paradise came to me. So it said to Talha, the great Sahabi, اِرْجِعْ فَإِنَّكَ لَمْ يَأْنِي لَكَ بَعْدٍ. He said, go back, for verily your time has not come yet. Your time has not come yet. So Talha came upon the morning, informing the people about that. They were amazed of what they heard, until that reached the Messenger of Allah, sallallahu alayhi wasallam, and they informed him of what Talha informed them. فَقَالْ مِنْ أَيِّ ذَلِكَ تَعْجَبُونَ. He said, from what are you amazed from? فَقَالُوا يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ هَذَا كَانَ أَشَدَّ الرَّجُلَيْنِ اجْتِهَادًا ثُمَّ اسْتُشْهِدْ. He said, firstly, O Messenger of Allah, the one who died and attained martyrdom in battle was more diligent in his efforts, in his work, in his work ethic, than the one who died a year after him. And despite of that, the one who died a year after him entered paradise before him. He said, Thumma stushhid. He said, not only was he diligent and hardworking, his work ethic was tremendous, but and also he attained martyrdom. So how did he precede his companion, him entering paradise before him? فَقَالَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ. He said, أَلَيْسَ قَدْ مَكَثَ هَذَا بَعْتَهُ سَنَةً. قَالُوا بَلَى. قَالَ وَأَدْرَكَ رَمَضَانَ. فَصَامَ وَصَلَّ كَذَا وَكَذَا مِنْ سَجْدَةٍ فِي السَّنَةِ. قَالُوا بَلَى. قَالَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ فَمَا بَيْنَهُمَا أَبْعَدُ مِمَّا بَيْنَ السَّمَاءِ وَالْأَرْضِ. It says in the last part of the hadith, he said, oh, Messenger of Allah, asking him, how did he precede him in entering paradise? Even though he was less hardworking, and he did not attain martyrdom, and he lived a year later. So the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, didn't the other remain an extra year? They said, of course. Did he not reach Ramadan, and he prayed, and he fasted, and he prayed such and such of prayer and prostration in the year? They said, yes. So the Messenger of Allah upon that, he said, for verily, مَا فَمَا بَيْنَهُمَا أَبْعَدُ مِمَّا بَيْنَ السَّمَاءِ وَالْأَرْضِ. He said, what is between those two individuals, because of this, what he just mentioned, he says, is further from what is between the heavens and the earth. To let one know the high level of Ramadan, and that Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala prefers some over others. For firstly, number one, from the benefits of this, you will find that Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala has allowed certain people to remain in this dunya longer than others. There's another narration you'll find where the Messenger of Allah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, طُوبَى لِمَنْ طَالَتْ حَيَاتُهُ وَحَسُنَ عَمَلُهُ. As the Messenger of Allah said, the tree for paradise or glad tidings to the one who lives a long life, and he has righteous actions, meaning that his action or the life that he has, even though he has longevity in his life, but he took advantage of it, of what? Increasing in righteous actions, until he took advantage of that extra time that Allah has given him. And this is the state of the companion of the one who died after. Allah bestowed his ni'mah upon him to remain in his dunya extra time, to take advantage of performing extra or additional righteous actions. So in regards to when he died, Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala allowed him to excel and exceed his companion in status. So this is to take in consideration that Allah has bestowed his blessing upon us where a lot of us are still living. And some of us who have now died from amongst us, that their ajal or their time is now stopped. But Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala has allowed us to still live, to give an opportunity for one to now attain this level, where it's to the point where we said this person attained martyrdom, set out in jihad, and also he was very diligent. And despite of that, his companion who lived a year longer than him, he excelled. He excelled because of the extra year that Allah had bestowed upon him of life expectancy and given him a bit more of longevity in his life. So this narration, this narration is authentic, as the great Imam al-Bani also authenticated. So you'll find that the virtue of Ramadan is from the benefits that extract of this hadith of how high a status it has with Allah, to the point where, like we mentioned in Ya Ma'ash al-Ikhwa, that one, that if he fasted that month and take advantage of it, and he utilizes it in order to remove and extinguish the fire of the evil that he's done prior, and now taking advantage of it in order for one's level to be raised, then that person can excel even the people who are very diligent that came before us, whose life expectancy was cut and they died earlier. So Allah has given us a blessing for where we still are in this world. So that's one benefit of the hadith, in which you'll find in the hereafter, notice the message of Allah clearly said in the narration. He said, what is between those two individuals? He says, the furthest of what is between the heavens and the earth. Allahu Akbar. So that's tremendous. Also, in regards to after we get the bishara, we want to give the nadara. After we give glad tidings, then we have to give the warnings. And then I'll leave off the lecture with this narration, in which, I wanted to be a little bit more in detail, but the time will not permit. But anyway, for the narration in regards to Abu Umama al-Bahili, where the message of Allah sallallahu alayhi wasallam had mentioned and said in another narration, and Abu Umama al-Bahili, the great Sahabi, his name is Suddi ibn Ajlan. Abu Umama al-Bahili, his real name was Suddi ibn Ajlan, the great Sahabi. Abu Umama al-Bahili, that he related, he says, سمعت رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم يقول بين أنا نائم إذ أتاني رجلان فأخذ بضبعي فأتيا بي جبلا وعرا فقال لي اصعد فقلت إني لا أطيقه فقال إنا سنسهله لك فصعدت حتى إذا كنت في سواء الجبل إذا أنا بأصوات شديدة فقلت ما هذه الأصوات قالوا هذه عواء أهل النار ثم انطلق بي فإذا أنا بقوم معلقين بعراقيبهم مشققة أشداقهم تسيل أشداقهم دما قال قلت من هؤلاء قال هؤلاء الذين يفطرون قبل تحلة صومهم. The hadith of Abu Umama al-Bahili, that the message of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that he said, hence I was asleep, and two men came to me, and he took me by my daba'i, by my shoulder. This part of this narration, and the one who came before, these two who came and spoke to the message of Allah in this narration, and Talha, all of them were what? Angels. For the one who came out the gate of paradise and told the other to enter, or the two men to enter, Then he went and said, it has not been given. Your time has not come yet. You'll find that Ahl al-Ilm said that that was an angel telling Talha, your time has not come. Go back to, for verily, your ajal, or your time is not what? It's not up yet. Meaning life, in the dunya, in this world. So go back. But also you'll find that narration, this one and the one preceded, you'll find that the angels came to Talha and said, your time has not come yet. You'll find in that narration that they say that that was a hint to show that Talha was going to paradise. That Talha was going to go to paradise. If you notice in the narration, it says, goes, go to paradise, the other one go to paradise, wait, your time hasn't come yet. So that's to also show that Talha was what? Was guaranteed, what everyone? Paradise. So Talha was given a messenger, meaning the angels who informed him. Similar to that, in this hadith of the Messenger of Allah, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, here, two angels came to the Messenger of Allah. They came to the Messenger of Allah and said to him, and he took him by his shoulder. He said, they came to a high, lofty mountain. He said, I'm not able to climb it. They said, climb it. He said, I'm not able. He said, verily, we'll facilitate it for you. He said, so I climbed it. He says, حَتَّى إِذَا كُنْتُ فِي سَوَاءِ الْجَبَلِ. He says, and I was in that straight part of the mountain where I heard horrific voices, people who were screaming in pain. And he said, what are these voices? He said, these are the howling or the screaming, the horrific screaming of the people of hell. He said, then they went about with me. And I came to a people who were being hung by their hamstrings. They were being hung by their hamstrings and their cheeks were being ripped and torn. He says, تَسِيلُ أَشْدَاقُهُمْ دَمًا. He said their sides, or where they were ripped on the sides of their faces, or on their sides, it was blood coming out. He said, well, who are these people? He said, these are the people that break their fast before it's time. These are the people that break their fast before it's time. Meaning, an excuse that's not from the Kitab and Sunnah. Meaning, of traveling or person being sick or what have you. Those people are excused. We're talking about people who do not have a proper excuse. That break their fast illegitimately. How do you say it, everyone? I said it close, right? Illegitimately. J. Huh? That was close enough. J. Those who break their fast in an illegitimate manner, or illegitimately, or improperly, or in an ill, or they, if you want to say, in an unlawful manner. For those who break their fast before the time of Maghrib, not for the time of the Adhan. A lot of people do based upon the Adhan, unless the Mu'adhan, of course, is Mundabit. He's accurate and precise in his Adhan. That's someone different. But the actual time where the person breaks their fast is when the sun is set and the person knows that it is set to the best of his ability. Upon that is when the what? The sun sets and it becomes permissible for one to break his or her fast. The person who does that before that time and they do not have a legitimate excuse from Kitab and Sunnah, then, like we said, he's subjected to this wa'id, this warning and this punishment that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam informed of. So in the month of Ramadan, this narration has also been collected in Al-Mundhiri, in his Targhib wa Tarhib, where Imam Al-Bani also declared it to be authentic. So that's to show, in one aspect, how fasting affects one's hereafter and his what? And his state as far as what will take place in the hereafter, and also the grave I'm going to speak about in a minute. So all this is to show that what one does in regards to establishing this worship, that it will affect one in the hereafter in so many ways. A way in which you'll find which happened with Talha and his companion, to the point, like we said, he reached a level that was greater in distance between what is of the heavens and the earth. And we have the opposite effect of those who did not take advantage of the month in obedience to Allah, rather they broke their fast in a time where it was not legislated, nor was it permissible, to now. Break their fast, and as a result of it, this tremendous punishment, which is a uquba, or a tremendous punishment that Allah has prepared for those who have not what, who have actually broke their fast and did not carry out that ibadah or that worship as it is, as has been legislated by Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala. There's other narrations that I wanted to speak about, but this is the one that I really wanted to what, break down. As you'll find, there's a narration which is in At-Tabari. It's in At-Tabari. It's also in Ibn Abi Dunya. It's in Al-Mu'jam Al-Awsat. And it's in others that's been collected of hadith. Rather, it's in Masanid. It's not in Ahad books. Ahad, it was in Masanid. In Mu'jam Al-Awsat is Masanid. You'll find a narration which is on the authority of some of the Abu Hurairah and others is Burayda ibn Husayb al-Aslami. Burayda ibn Husayb al-Aslami. This is the hadith that I really want to break down for everyone. There's a narration on the authority, like I said, one is on the authority of Burayda ibn Husayb al-Aslami. And another is upon Abu Hurairah. With the message of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that he mentioned and said, learn Surah Al-Baqarah. For verily, learning it is blessing. Leaving it is remorse and regret. And those who are upon falsehood are not able to what? They are not able to do it. We're going to explain it, inshallah. Don't worry. Or they cannot tolerate it. Those who are upon batil, those who are upon falsehood cannot what? Tolerate. I'm going to explain it, inshallah. Don't worry. The Quran will come on the day of resurrection, like a man changing various colors. كَالرَّجُلِ الشَّاحِبِ. Like a man changing various colors. And he will say to his companion, do you know me? So you have two instances where one's deeds will come to him. Because I'm going to explain the meaning of this hadith. You have one in the grave. And you have one on the day of resurrection when one comes out of the grave. So it's two instances. You have one in the grave. Your deeds will come to you. Either in a very horrific, evil, frightening manner when you've done evil in this dunya. You're not upheld the boundaries that Allah has set. You're not maintained that obedience and adhere to that obedience. You could go back there. Is it open now? Because he might have to go around. Those who did not adhere to their obedience, who their deeds will come in a frightful manner and scare one while he is in the grave. Similar to that, on the day of resurrection, a person likewise, when he comes and he's resurrected, it says the Quran will come to him. I'm going to explain this because I don't want everyone to think the Quran is created. Because I'm going to explain that, inshallah. So what is the meaning here is the Quran will come. Just listen. So it says in the narration, كَالرَّجَلِ الشَّاحِبِ, changing colors. Changing different colors. He says, the Quran will say to his companion, do you know me? He said, verily, I'm the one that made you stay up late at night without any sleep during your nights. And he said, and I made you thirsty during the afternoons. And every merchant or businessman will be behind his tijara, behind his business. He will be behind his merchandise or his business. وَأَنَا لَكَ الْيَوْمْ مِنْ وَرَاءِ كُلِّ تَاجِرِ. And I'm with you today will be with you. I will be behind every merchant. And we'll talk about the meaning of it, inshallah. He said, meaning with you, I will be behind every tajir, meaning the person who actually traded with Allah in a good manner based upon his faith and based upon his good deeds. As we know, Ya Ma'ashul Ikhwa, that Allah in his book describes doing righteousness as a type of what? Tijara. You'll find that Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala mentions that in his book. Tijara means a type of business or trade or sell or what have you. That Allah does mention that in his book. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the ayah, يَرَجُونَ تِجَارَةً لَن تَبُورَ. He says that those, they hope for a tijara, a type of business that it will not fail or it will not disgrace them. Meaning they will attain their benefits and their earnings. So this in this hadith is saying that verily with you today, I will be behind every merchant. فَيُعْطَى الْمُلْكُ بِيَمِينِ. He'll be giving the dominion in his right hand and immortality in his left hand. And it will be put over his head, tajul waqar. It will be put over his head, a crown of honor. And he will be given, his two parents will be given, hullatani. They will be given those two garments, or those two thobes, or hulla means like two garments. He says, nothing is similar to it in the dunya. And we'll talk about the meaning of this. Meaning, just those two garments is better what is in this dunya and everything that is in it, as we'll discuss, inshallah. He says, وَمَا فِيهَا لَا يَقُومُ لَهُمَ الدُّنْيَا وَمَا فِيهَا فَيَقُولَانِ. The two parents will say, our Lord, how is it that we have all of this? He says, because of you teaching your child the Qur'an. We'll talk about this, inshallah, we'll break it down. He says, وَإِنَّ صَاحِبَ الْقُرْآنِ يُقَالُ لَهُ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ اِقْرَأْ وَرْقَى فِي الدَّرَجَاتِ فَإِنَّ مَنْزِلَكَ عِنْدَ آخِرِ آيَةٍ مَعَكَ. As it will be said to him on the day of resurrection, he said, read, recite, and descend. Meaning ascend in degrees. And recite, just as you used to recite in this world, for verily your place will be at the last ayah you recite in. So this narration is tremendous. There's another narration that says, where the Messenger of Allah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam has said, Ta'allamu az-Zahrawaini. He called the recital or learning Surah Al-Ali Imran, the Surah Al-Baqarah, az-Zahrawaini. Or Zahrawani. Az-Zahrawani. The Zahrawani meaning those two that will give light on the day of resurrection. That will give light to one on the day of resurrection. Meaning, Zahrawani mean Muniratani. Muniratani. That will give light to one on the day of resurrection. He says, in another narration, the Messenger of Allah says, this is Abu Huraira, he said, فَإِنَّهُمَا يَأْتِيَانِ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ كَأَنَّهُمَا غَيَايَتَانِ أَوْ غَمَامَتَانِ يَظِلَّانِ أَوْ فِي رِوَايَةِ يُحَاجَّانِ عَنْ أَصْحَابِهِمَا. He said, for verily, the Qur'an will come on the day of resurrection, غَيَايَتَانِ أَوْ غَمَامَتَانِ أَوْ فِرْقَانِ مِنْ طَيْرٍ صَوَافِ يُحَاجَّانِ عَنْ أَصْحَابِهِمَا. Now it's starting to all come back to me. But anyway, what it says in the first part of the narration, where it says that the Messenger of Allah describes Surah Ali Imran, Surah Al-Baqarah as a Zahrawani. As we know that the month of Ramadan is the month of Quran. So listen to this narration. So one, it says that the narration says that the Quran will come on the day of resurrection in a certain manner. The fa'ida aqadiyya, or the side benefit that's pertaining to the belief system based upon this narration, one would think that the Quran is created. Don't worry, I'm going to mention all that. Before I enter inside the answers, inshallah, the answers to these narrations, one has to have the i'tiqad, that is the ijma' yama'ash al-ikhwa of the salaf, that the Quran is not created. So what's the answer to these narrations? I'm going to talk about it in a minute, don't worry. But firstly, that is the ijma' that the Quran and the speech of Allah is not makhluq. It's not created. So what is the tawjih, the response to this narration here? I'm going to talk about it in a minute if I have time.
Where did time go? The time, man. I'm trying to close out.
So, the Messenger of Allah in one part of the narration described that the Quran, the Surah Al-Imran and Surah Al-Baqarah is described as a Zahrawani. A Zahrawani meaning Muniratani. The two things that will give light to the one who memorized and also implemented them. We're going to talk about that, inshallah. Not only recited them in the nighttime, but also implemented what is in them of ahkam. So it's not just merely the recital, as we're going to talk about, inshallah. Zahrawan. So the message of Allah said it will come on the day of resurrection. So keep in mind, a person would think the Quran is created. So the surah is going to come on the day of resurrection. And it will be as if it's ghayayatani or ghamamatani. Some of Ahl ilm say that the meaning of it is clear, self-evident, or self-explanatory, which is ghamamatani, two clouds. That's one narration. Two clouds, of course we know, is utilized to give shade. To give shade. And there's another narration that says that. That what? That those two surah will give shade on the day of resurrection. If they're recited, they recited properly, and they're also implemented upon. So they will give what? They will give shade. So that's one narration. So one narration says there will be two lights after the darkness on the day of resurrection, because we know there will be a lot of darkness on the day of resurrection. There will be a lot of darkness. And the only light that one have is based upon what's mentioned in those authentic narrations in regards to what the message of Allah spoke about wudu, and the one, his deeds and his actions, that will also be his light. It will be illuminating, dependent on how much his obedience was in his dunya. Will be relying on how strong his light will be on the day of resurrection. So you have those narrations in regards to what we're mentioning here now. So those two surah will be enlightening one and giving light to one after darkness as what? And so what darkness will take place on the day of resurrection. Then you have the message of Allah describing Surah Al-Baqarah, Ali Imran, as being ghamamatani, two clouds that will give shade. Or ghayayatani. Ghayayatani or firqani min taydin sawaf. Ghamamatani, two clouds. But ghayayatani, they say, is something that was utilized to just give shade in general. Ghamam means clouds. Ghaya or ghayayatani is generally used for something that will give you shade. Of somewhat what we want to understand as somewhat of an umbrella. Allah knows best of exactly of what is intended, but we know it's going to be something that will be utilized as giving one shade. And that should be enough. Ghayayatani. Then it says, Firqani min taydin sawaf. Firqani, meaning it will also come in a form of what we will understand as a group of birds that are in a huge group with their wings spread it out. With their wings spread it out. So for what we understand from this, based upon this narration and the others, is that we know that they will come giving shade to the individual. Whether it be two clouds, whether it be something that will give shade generally, or whether it be from those birds that have their wings spread, we know that the ultimate meaning, just to summarize and make everything straight to the point, is that it will be something that will give shade to the individual from the punishment of Allah on the day of resurrection. Then the message of Allah, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, like we said, he mentioned about now. He said in regards to this narration, Ta'allam al-Baqarah, for verily, he says, memorizing it will be barakah, and leaving it off will be regret. What is the meaning of the narration? It says, وَلَا يَسْتَطِيعُ هَالْبَطَلَ. Those who's upon batil are not able to what? To do it. What does he mean? One of the meanings is Ahl ilm say that the meaning of this narration is, meaning those who practice magic cannot memorize it. Those who practice magic cannot memorize these two surah. They cannot memorize it. Another meaning of it is that those who recite it cannot be affected by the magicians. That's another meaning of the narration. Those who recite Surah Al-Baqarah and Ali Imran will not be affected by the magicians. They will not be affected by the magicians. I mean, their magic will not be able to affect them. So it can mean either what? Either one or the two, both of them are correct. So now the message of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he goes on to say, يجيء القرآن يوم القيامة كالرجل الشاحب that the Quran will come on the day of resurrection in a manner or the form of a man changing colors. كالرجل الشاحب يعني متغير اللون, changing colors. What is the meaning of that? The meaning of متغير الرجل الشاحب, meaning متغير اللون بحسب العوارض التي طرأت عليه في الدنيا. The meaning of shahib is based upon one's different conditions and states and stages that he went through in his life and his dunya, will also be the same state of how the Quran, as we're going to explain the meaning of the Quran here, because I don't want nobody to think the Quran is created. So Quran will come similar to that on the day of resurrection, meaning that you were in different states. Sometime you were tired, sometime you were exhausted, sometime you were praying, sometime you were fasting, sometime you were doing this, sometime you were doing that. You were changing, your state was constantly changing in this world. Based upon the different what? Awadit, or the adit, or the different types of circumstances that you were under. This is how the Quran will come. And one narration says, فَإِنَّ الْقُرْآنَ يَلْقَى صَاحِبَهُ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ أَوَّلُ مَا يَنْشَقُ عَنْهُ قَبْرُهُ. It says in the narration that the Quran will meet him. I'm going to explain this, because like we said, the Quran is غَيْرُ مَخْلُوقُ. So what is the fa'idah aqadiyah in this regard? What is the benefit of that is in regards to the aqidah? I'm going to explain it, don't worry. He says that the Quran will first meet the person once he comes out of the grave. And he will meet him soon as he wakes up on the day of resurrection. Soon as he comes out the grave. أَوَّلُ مَا يَنْشَقُ عَنْهُ قَبْرُ. He says that the Quran will say, do you know me? Do you know me? هَلْ تَعْرِفُنِي? Do you know me? He said, verily I am the one. And this is why I want everybody to be attentive of, because this is the part where it shows it's not just enough for memorizing it. It's also acting upon it. And now I'm going to connect it now with Ramadan, right now. So then it goes on to say, كالرجل الشاحب يقول لصاحبه هل تعرفني? He said, أنا الذي كنت أسهر ليلك وأضمئ هواجرك وإن كل تاجر من وراء تجارته وأنا لك اليوم من وراء كل تاجر. To the end of it. He says, then he said, عليه الصلاة والسلام, that he says, you know me, I am the one who made you stay up without any sleep in the night. Huh? What is he speaking about here? Meaning you implemented it, you implemented it. You worked upon it, you played at night, and I kept you up. Which is connected with what? Ramadan, no doubt. Well, this is the part we'll let you know, it's also speaking about Ramadan and other than Ramadan. وَأُذْمِئُ هَوَاجِرَكَ. I made you thirsty throughout the different days and the afternoon. For verily every tajir, every merchant is behind his tijara, is behind his business. And I belong to you, I'm behind every merchant. Meaning of who? Of those who did a proper type of what? Business with Allah, as far as with good deeds. In exchange to what Allah will give them as a reward or punishment. And that's a type of business. It is. That's the reason why Allah described it. You find that Ibn al-Qayyim even mentioned that. That Allah describes that what one does between him and his Lord is a type of tijara. It's a type of business. Which Allah Tabari wa ta'ala even says, يَرْجُونَ تِجَارَةً لَن تَبُورَ. Then the day where the people hope for a tijara or business, that it will not be destructive. It will not be destructive. So it says in the Quran that he mentioned, وَأَنَا لَكَ الْيَوْمِ مِنْ وَرَاءِ كُلِّ تَاجِرٍ. So now I'm going to go to the other benefits. I'll have to stop soon. So now in regards, so when he says, فَيُعْطَى الْمُلْكِ بِيَمِينِ, he said that the mulk, or the kingdom, or the dominion will be put, or be given, in his right hand. He says, as far as in regards to now what we're mentioning for the fa'idah or the benefit of this particular narration here, He says, firstly, before, well, I could do that after. He says, before, we know that when one is put in his grave, the amalul insan, and this is what I want everyone to tie everything in regards to also the Quran, and also one's fasting. The meaning of, especially, now let's go back to the life in the grave. Anna amalul insan bi qira'ati al-baqara. The actions of a person is a reciting of Surah Al-Baqarah Ali Imran. يَأْتِي كَأَنَّهُمَا غَمَامَتَانِ وَغَيَايَتَانِ وَفِرْقَانِ مِنْ طَيْنٍ صَوَافٍ وَمَعْرُوفَنَ الْبَقَرَةَ وَآلِ عِمْرَانِ كَلَامُ اللَّهِ كَمَا جَاءَ فِي الْحَدِيثِ الْآخَرِ أَنَّ الْإِنسَانِ إِذَا وُضِعَ فِي قَبْرِهِ جَاءَهُ رَجُلٌ حَسَنُ الْوَجْهِ حَسَنُ الصُّورَةِ طَيِّبُ الرِّيحِ فيقول من أنت فيقول أنا عملك الصالح. As it says in the narration, he says that the man, when a person is put in their grave under the dirt, a man comes to him having a pleasant face, a pleasant image, a good fragrance. He says, and the person in the grave will say, who are you? He says, I am your righteous actions. How is that connected with the Quran? Because the Quran also, we'll talk about inshallah in a minute, the Quran is not the Quran. Rather, you'll find with Shaykh al-Islam, we're going to mention exactly what Shaykh al-Islam and Taymiyyah says, it's the reward that will come. And Allah will make the reward to speak. And he will make it in a manner to speak to you, your reward or your punishment. Allah will make it in a manner where your reward will speak, the Quran will not speak, rather it's the reward. Exactly what Imam al-Albani mentioned and said in regards to the hadith on the authority of Abdullah ibn Amr ibn al-As, that the message of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, As-siyam wal-Quran yashfa'ani lil-abdi yawm al-qiyamah, yaqul as-siyam rabbi mana'tu al-ta'am wal-shahwa. To the end of the hadith, he says that once fasting, the Quran will intercede for the slave or the abd on the day of resurrection. The siyam will say, oh my Lord, I prevented him from eating and his desires, from he being intimate with his spouse, for allow me to intercede for him. The Quran will say similar to that, I prevented him from sleeping at night, allow me to intercede for him. They will be granted to intercede for the person. Listen what the great Imam al-Albani mentions and says. He says, يُشَفِّعَهُمَ اللَّهُ فِيهِ وَيُدْخِلُهُ الْجَنَّةِ قَالَ الْمَنَاوِي فِي فَيْدِ الْقَدِيرِ هَذَا الْقَوْلِ يُحْتَمَلُ أَنَّهُ حَقِيقَةُ بِأَنْ يُجَسِّدَ ثَوَابَهُمَا وَيَخْلُقُ اللَّهُ فِيهِ النُّطْقِ وَاللَّهُ عَلَى كُلِّ شَيْءٍ قَدِيرٍ وَيُحْتَمَلُ أَنَّهُ عَلَى ضَرْبٍ مِنَ الْمَجَازِ وَهَذَا بَاطِلٌ وَالتَّمْثِيلُ قُلْتُ وَالْأَوَّلُ هُوَ الصَّوَابُ الَّذِي يَنْبَغِي الْجَزْمُ بِهِ هُنَا وَفِي أَمْثَالِهِ مِنَ الْأَحَادِيثِ الَّتِي فِيهَا تجسيد الأعمال ونحوها كمثل تجسيد الكنز شجاعا أقرع ونحوه كثير وتأويل مثل هذه النصوص ليس من طريقة السلف رضي الله عنهم بل هو من طريقة المعتزلة ومن سلك مسلكهم من الخلف. He says that one of the meanings that Allah will allow the Quran and one's fasting to intercede, Allah will allow them both to intercede on the day of resurrection, and as a result of it, he will enter him into paradise. He said this statement necessitates, one, that truly, that Allah will allow the rewards to have some type of what? Some type of formation. Meaning it will be in a form of what they call tajseed, of something they will be able to recognize will be in a type of form. That Allah will make it a jasad, or make it a type of form where one can see. He said, يُجَسِّدُ ثَوَابَهُمَا. He will make his reward to see, in which Allah will create in it the ability to speak. And Allah is able to do all things. Now listen to the other part. He says, it's also some people will understand and say that it's probably a type of a metaphoric meaning. Metaphoric meaning. Or similarity, or some type of similarity, or what have you. Qultu, the great Imam al-Albani, goes on to say, the first one is correct. So notice that he what? Negates metaphoric majaz.
As I said last week in where is it? Baltimore. Negated what? Majaz. He said the first one is correct. He said all the narrations, he said it is yanbaghi, rather it's obligatory to have surety if this is the meaning or what is similar to it of the narrations which is in it, in which Allah will make actions like in a formation or something that is formed that you'll be able to see, that is what? That is feasible. That can be what? In a form where one can touch or where one can see, and it will actually speak and it will talk. And you said we have narrations that are what? Like that. In which we know Allah to be with the Allah will weigh one on the day of resurrection with three things. As we know from the three things that will be weighed on the day of resurrection from everyone will be one of three things, depending on the circumstance of the individual. One, his deeds will be what? Weighed, which is to show that Allah will give good deeds and bad deeds some type of formation, because it will have to be put on a scale and it be weighed. So that B will be made in a certain form that has weight. So that's one. And we know the second thing that will be weighed on the day of resurrection is the scrolls in which the deeds are written in, as it comes in the one narration. The Sahaif will also be weighed. And we know the third thing that will be weighed on the day of resurrection is the person himself, as it comes in certain narrations. The person himself will be put in the scale and be weighed, as it comes in the hadith of Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, where he said, the Prophet ﷺ, he says, أَتَضْحَكُونَ مِنْ دِقَّةِ سَاقِي فَوَاللَّهِ إِنَّهُمَا لَأَثْقَلُ فِي الْمِيزَانِ مِنْ جَبَلِ أُحُدٍ. He says, are you laughing at the little, how small his legs are and how petite they are? He said, verily they are in the scales with Allah heavier than Jabal Uhud, the mountain of Uhud. So that shows right there that what? That the person themselves will also be weighed on the day of resurrection. So all this is to prove what? And what are we concluding, everyone? What are we summing up from this? That the actions on the day of resurrections will be in some type of form. And that is what's correct in regards to these narrations. It will come in a form, and it will come either in the grave in the form of a man. But on the day of resurrection, it will come either of the reward of the person. The reward will come. And we'll talk about what Shaykh al-Islam Taymiyyah says and what Ibn al-Qayyim mentions in Nuniyah, because I want to bring that too. What Ibn al-Qayyim says in Nuniyah is very beneficial, because I wanted to bring his poetry, because he has a poetry about this hadith here. He has a poetry on it. The great Imam Ibn al-Qayyim al-Jawziyyah, rahimahullah. He has even a poetry in Nuniyah about this. But at any rate, just to sum it up, it says, who are you? He says, one narration talks about in your grave, a man will approach you having a pleasant image or a pleasant smell. He says, I am your good deed. So when this narration says here, that it's a man or a form of a man. There's another narration, likewise, similar. وَالْفَاجِرْ يَأْتِيهِ رَجُلٌ قَبِيحُ الْوَجْهِ مُنْتِنُ الرِّيحِ فَيَقُولْ مَنْ أَنْتِ فَوَجْهُكَ الْوَجْهِ فَوَجْهُكَ الْوَجْهِ يَجِيءُ بِالشَّرِّ فَيَقُولْ أَنَا عَمَلُكَ الْخَبِيثِ. He says the evil individual, now also people who is wretched in this world, he says a man will come and have an uglified face, very horrific, unpleasant face coming at him in the grave. He says, who are you? He's going to be startled, frightened. Who are you? He says, you are a face that seems like it's giving glad tidings of evil. فَوَجْهُكَ الْوَجْهِ يَجِيءُ بِالشَّرِّ. You're bringing evil. He says, I'm your wicked actions. أَنَا عَمَلُكَ الْخَبِيثِ. We have to stop to pray. I will stop to pray. Thought I will stop to pray. Maybe we could continue after the salah. I will continue after the salah. Thought we'd stop and pray, Maghrib inshallah.